Well, good morning. I'm here with Shannon Kerr. She is also a speech-language pathologist, but unlike the speech pathologists we've spoken with up until now, her practice actually happens to be in the hospital. So she has actually been impacted quite dramatically by the pandemic. So she'll tell us all about that today. But first of all, maybe Shannon, you can introduce yourself, let us know what population you work with. You don't have to tell us what hospital you're at, but maybe just let us know kind of what type of clinic you're at and that kind of thing.
Absolutely. Yeah. So I'm working at a hospital here in Edmonton, and I work with the head and neck cancer population for the most part. I work on a multidisciplinary team, and we provide various services to people with head and neck cancer.
Well, that's great. And so walk me a little bit through the history of things. Kind of what has happened and how has that impacted your clinical life? I know everyone's personal life has also been impacted, but your clinical life, that must have been turned upside down, I imagine, like most people working in hospitals right now.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, during the pandemic, there's definitely been a lot of ups and downs and changes. And we've just, the name of the game is flexibility. And okay, you know, because things might change by the hour as to what we're doing, what's needed. And so trying to figure out both how to help our patients and then also help out during the pandemic in general. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, at the beginning of the pandemic, when we weren't seeing people, patients in person, we were also helping out at the hospital by doing door screenings, being the people taking the temperature and people doing the questionnaires, because just they needed hands on deck to help at the hospital, making sure things were safe for staff and for patients. So I think the name of the game is flexibility and just finding out at each moment sort of how we can best serve our patients and help the hospital as a whole.
Right. Yeah, I can only imagine what that must have been like for you and your colleagues. Are you now doing some of the practice on telehealth, or are you starting to see patients in person? What has that been like now that lockdown has been opened up a bit, so to speak?
Yeah. So we haven't seen in-person patients very much, except for on an emergent basis, and especially again up and downs with the pandemic, outbreaks at various locations that we have to make sure that are contained and are safe. And so we haven't seen very much in person. A lot of it has gone online to teletherapy. And so one of the nice things is that I've been able to have more time for therapy. We've still been doing assessment online, but also I've been able to do teletherapy, especially speech and voice is what I've been doing a fair bit of with our head and neck population. And that's been very nice to be able to have some time to focus on, especially since we haven't been able, except for an emergent basis, to bring in people in person, we haven't been doing as many in-person swallow tests. And that's one of the things that takes up a lot of our time. And of course, we want to be able to get back to doing more of those as it's, as we get the processes in place to make that safe and viable. Yeah, because we didn't have the swallow tests and all the, you have to analyze the videos, and we had more time to be able to do things like online therapies, which was in some ways a benefit, one of the nice things that came of this.
Yeah, that's really nice to hear. I hadn't actually even thought of that. So what has that been like for you? Have you, because you've done in-person therapy and you've done some telehealth, and, be honest, has it been nice? Have there been challenges? And I'm sure you'll be speaking for lots of people with similar experiences.
Sure, absolutely. Yeah. When I first started, I wasn't sure what the sound quality would be like over Zoom. And so I was like, it's not going to be as ideal as sitting in the room with the person, but let's at least try. I wasn't sure, as you see, I've got a headphone that just has one ear. I was like, do you know what? I don't think I'm going to be able to, I want that two headphone. So I wasn't sure how I would be able to hear. But I've been pleasantly surprised when it comes to speech and voice therapy. I feel like I can hear well enough to hear little nuances in the speech, and so that I can, give them little guidance and nudge and things like that. I've been pleasantly surprised. And even this, I might move to a two-ear headset at some point, but even this way, I find has been very good. So it's been quite a positive experience. The patients really love it because they don't have to leave their homes.
I know, right?
You know, yeah. There's no travel time. They don't have to pay parking fees. They just, you know, wake up in the morning, go about their business. And then when it's time, they click on, talk to me for a while and then go back their lives. And I find that also I'm able to get more of them in a day because, you know, when they're here in person, you know, I go collect them from the waiting room, bring them down, you know, do the appointment, then I kind of walk them back up. So all of that sort of extra time, I do love that time too, right? The chatting with the patient, and we still do some of that during the appointment, but it's kind of nice to be like, and we're done the appointment and, you know, I don't have to kind of escort them anywhere. Mm-hmm. So it's made for kind of nice, still with a lot of rapport, but efficient appointment. So I've really liked that a lot.
Right. And it's funny you mentioned that. I was actually thinking of you a few months ago. So as you remember, I dabbled in guitar, and that has gone on Zoom as well. And, you know, before I used to have to drive to the place where the lessons were. So that was like 35 minutes there, 35 minutes back, plus like running out the door and the whole process for me. Yeah. But now I just log in, and what's nice about it too is in the group setting is I can either mute everybody else and just hear my guitar, and I can actually hear myself and correct. And then, you know, the instructor, same thing, he can mute us and walk around, whereas in the same room, it was a bit of a gong show. So I actually quite prefer it, like you said. I'm wondering if you're finding that your patients or clients are hearing themselves a bit better now that they're kind of in their own room, where maybe I'm wondering if maybe some of that carryover is happening a bit better. Have you noticed any of that?
No, definitely. I think they're just more comfortable because it's their space, right? And it's nice in terms of having a spouse or something around. The spouse doesn't have to take time off work to come with them if they're at the house anyways, which a lot of people are during this pandemic. And also with the age bracket that I work with, you know, a fair number are retired. So the spouse can be kind of around and keeping an ear, but also, you know, going about their house business too. They're not just stuck in this hospital room listening to the patient's appointment. So I think that's helpful because I think we all know when we have those patients that have a really good spousal support or caregiver support of some kind, that's really helpful to have that second set of ears, be like, remember Shannon said that, you know, just to remember that information that's been passed along in the session. Yeah. So, yeah, I think the patients are feeling comfortable. It's easier for their significant other or someone else to be around. Mm-hmm. And yeah, there isn't the distraction of, oh, they're seeing people passing by the clinic door or, you know, it's just us. And so I think it is pretty easy for them to focus on what we're doing. So, yeah, I think it's been good.
Good. That's awesome. Is there anything that you feel you're missing? I'm sure there are, you know, benefits. Positives and negatives to each side. Is there anything that you feel you're missing right now from the in-person?
Every once in a while, like there was a patient I had the other day and we're working on it. And head and neck cancer, you really have to play around, right? Because it's new anatomy in the mouth. So there's not like one cookie cutter way to be like, do this and then you'll be able to make your R again. So it's a lot of playing and suggestions like, what if you try to make it on that side of your mouth or try to think of this or keep this lip out of the way. And so for the most part, it's been okay over teletherapy. I did have a patient the other day. It was like, I said to him, I'm like, I wish I could just reach through the camera and touch your face for a second. Because in the clinic, in the before times, I could, right? I could say, you know, what if you kind of, you know, like, and you could just give some little, touch cues, tactile cues. So I have found every once in a while that I just wanted to touch their face. And there's also in terms of swallow therapy, we're able to do certain types of swallow therapy over teletherapy, but it's harder to do other types. So to do the traditional exercises, it's pretty okay. When we're teaching things like Mendelsohn and stuff, usually here in the clinic, we do have the benefit of having the SEMG equipment to sort of teach them the right shape of what it should look like, or maybe how for the effortful, how high they should go. Mm-hmm. So we are missing that, but we can do those traditional exercises over teletherapy. But then something like McNeil, dysphagia therapy program, you can't really start it just on teletherapy. Mm-hmm. I believe Dr. Carnaby has said that at some point, after some in-person sessions, if they're really, if you know that they have the form, you're feeling confident and they're at a certain level. Mm-hmm. I believe she said that she has done some of that over teletherapy, but it's definitely not a only teletherapy, at least in what, from what I've seen, something that you can just start on teletherapy, because mm-hmm. you need that person in person to make sure they're safe and to make sure you're catching all of the information that you need. So,
So you've done some swallowing therapy on telehealth. You've got my interest piqued. What sort of, exercises or how has that been working out? I'm trying to envision it.
So, we've done some teletherapy over Zoom like this, and then previously in the before times, we would also sometimes use telehealth equipment, even if someone was out of town. And I'm actually finding that I like the Zoom better. Mm-hmm. One, because often the patient is positioned a little closer to the camera. I know that on the telehealth equipment, you can zoom in, and because I often like to look at their throat and see how things are moving, or see, to kind of look for those signs that they're using enough effort. And so it's been okay on telehealth, but I actually like it over teletherapy. I find that, even looking at you here, I find I can see your whole head and neck. I'm doing some swallowing exercises right now with the patient, and I feel I can count the swallows and get a good sense that he's doing it right. Mm-hmm. Do you know what? I think you need to hold that Mendelsohn a little longer, a little higher. So, yeah.
Do you have them facing on, or do you have them facing sideways?
Good question. Yeah, mostly on. But now that you say sideways, I'm going to try different positions. That's great. Yeah.
Yeah. Cool. That's really interesting. I've noticed, and I haven't seen anyone do this, but I've noticed it in some photos where people have put in like a little piece of tape or something to mark the thyroid and see. It might be easier for you to see. I don't know, but
that's cool. I like that. Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Yeah.
Well, that's awesome. Any words of wisdom or words of advice that you'd like to impart on somebody who's just starting out potentially? I know there's quite a lot of students who are heading out right now. I feel for them and are doing this for the first time, or in placements for the first time, or even clinicians out there who are just starting to dabble with telehealth.
Yeah. One of the sort of basic housekeeping suggestions is to, if you have a patient that you're doing teletherapy with, making sure you have information that would help you in an emergency situation. Because, if I am in the clinic with a patient and they have a fall, I am here, I can call a code, the help is all nearby. But what if you're having a teletherapy session and someone has a fall and you're just staring at them helplessly? So I always make sure I know their phone number, I know their address that they're at, so that I know how to call emergency services. This is likely not going to happen, but I think it's one thing that's important when doing teletherapy, because you are responsible for them, right? You are the healthcare provider at the moment. So that's just kind of a basic housekeeping suggestion. Another suggestion is working with the patient to figure out how they position their tablet or smartphone so that they're in a good position so you can see their head and their neck. I have one patient who I think he uses a tablet, and then he has progressive lenses or whatever it is. And so I often see him looking down at the my screen like this, and then look where his head is. Mm-hmm. And we're doing voice therapy and his chin is way high. So thinking about how the technology might cause differences in head position that might affect your therapy, right? So I try and remind him, chin down in a nice neutral position, because we don't want to get that tight pulled larynx.
That's good advice, Shannon. And it's funny, when I started doing this, I was a little worried that after a while the advice would start to be the same.
Yeah.
It hasn't been at all the same. Every time I speak to someone new, it's like something different pops up. So that's really neat. Really like your idea of having some emergency contacts nearby. Mm-hmm. I'm wondering, now that you've mentioned it, and so this is the last question. I've asked you a lot of hard questions.
That's fine.
Are you responsible for the patient right now when you are doing this face-to-face, even if they're in a different home? I'm just wondering what that's working like, and if you have an idea, and if not, that's fine too.
Sort of in a legal sense, no, I don't really know for sure. It's just more that as a healthcare provider, if I'm in an appointment with someone and something does go wrong, I would want to, you know, I would feel like I had to do something. I don't know the legality of it, whether I'd be, you know, liable for anything, but it just makes sense that, yeah, if a patient starts having a stroke or something, it's like, you know, I'm not there with them. So I need to make sure that I have some way of making sure services get to them as soon as possible. And I'm not fumbling around for, oh, what's their phone number? Is this the address they're at? Yeah. Again, hopefully you never need to use it.
No. But it's good that you're prepared. That's excellent. Well, thank you so much, Shannon. I hope you have a wonderful day in clinic today and that you have some nice therapy sessions lined up. And just out of curiosity, have you switched back to modified barium swallows? I know this question's on everybody's mind right now, and fees and anything like that at your clinic.
Yeah, so we did have to make sure we had the procedures in place and the cleaning in place. And again, due to where the pandemic was at the time or outbreaks and things like that. So we are getting back to in-person swallow studies, which is really great. So we're doing MBSs. And so that feels really good to do. And one of the nice things too is that since our patient population is primed to use Zoom now, because before, you know, people in their 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, you know, might not have really known how to use Zoom. So one thing the pandemic has done is to prime people, because this is how they talk to their grandkids. So we can now try to minimize the amount of time in the hospital by doing maybe a pre-appointment where we gather all the information so that we know what we're going to assess in terms of their swallowing when they get here. They can come in quickly for that appointment, the in-person MBS, get it done, then they head on out all nice and safe, and then we can analyze the video and do another Zoom call to show them the results later and to play that video through. And before, I really like to show them in the room right after, but in some ways it's nice to analyze it first, right? You know, because even if you think that you know, it's nice to have run through it, really thought it through before you present the results to the patient. And now we don't have to call them back in for that. We can just do that over Zoom and share your screen and show them the video and explain it. So,
wow, that sounds actually quite nice. Yeah. I don't say so myself yet. you know, in some ways, I'm hoping that some of these, I'll call them silver linings of the pandemic, remain, because it does sound like in many ways life is a bit more convenient for our patients right now, and you are able to share more information from what I'm hearing, and have a bit more time to spend in therapy with them, and more focused, it sounds like.
And during this pandemic time too, people are stuck at home more. Mm-hmm. And, you know, our patients, our head and neck cancer patients were already a bit stuck at home, but because maybe they don't feel comfortable going out due to speech and swallowing concerns. But people are really at home and feeling a bit isolated and are ready to do something, right? They don't have that busy schedule right now. So they're like, sure, I'll do speech therapy. Sure, I'll do swallow therapy. I'm here, you know, and it's nice. And there's also the, you know, we're here for the therapy, but it's also just nice for them to see a face, you know, on a regular basis, one or two or three times a week, have someone helping them through what they're going through. And because they're dealing with both head and neck cancer and the isolation of pandemic. And so it's nice to have someone who's, that they feel is supporting them and is, you know, creating that rapport with them. Yeah.
Sure.
And one thing actually that I find helps with that rapport on calls is the eye contact situation. I don't know if you have this feeling on Zoom where you're talking to someone and they're looking, you know, at your picture, but they're looking at this. So can I show you one quick little screen share? Am I able to share my screen? It's okay. I can't because I'm not the host. But that's fine. I can also just explain it. So whatever. So one thing that I like to do, so when I'm sharing my screen and I've got the word list up, when you first bring that up, the word list, the screen you're sharing is off to one side, and then you see yourself in a little screen and the patient in a little screen, right? Yeah. And so this is probably something most people know, but just in case, you can pin the video for the patient so you see just them. And so it's kind of nice to not see yourself anymore, because I think that's what people say kind of contributes to Zoom fatigue, mm-hmm. is to kind of deal with seeing all of your emotions and they're kind of a little out of sync. So you can't see yourself anymore. And then I like to enlarge my patient's picture and put it right underneath the camera so that it's very close to look up to, and I can talk to them looking up like this. And then when I look at them, it's not a big eye movement, and it's not this, right? Mm-hmm. Like, oh, hi, Mr. Smith, how are you doing today? That's great. You know, mm-hmm. It still kind of looks like you're looking at them, although you're looking just underneath the camera. So those type of things, I think, can really help with that rapport and feeling that you're actually there with them and talking to them. So yeah. Just little things like that, I think, make a difference.
Wow, Shannon, a gold mine of information today. Thank you so much for sharing all these tips and tricks. I'm thinking right now out loud, because most of your patients are head and neck cancer patients. It would be nice to share this on our Facebook group as well with our head and neck cancer peers. So
absolutely.
Thank you. Take care. Have a nice weekend ahead. And thanks for giving us your time today.
Absolutely. It was a pleasure. Thanks, Gabby.